Dear Charlotte, language begins in joy. Today I saw my publisher. He said to me, all the phenomena in the world are just signs for other truths. Our job as humans is to find out what each thing represents. I think he was talking about my writing. One of the truths, he continued, of human existence is a malignancy. Malignant because it's real and we can't understand it. I hate this truth, which manifests itself as the fact that human life is suffering. People have and do live in pain. He pounded his fist against the table until he bled in order to prove this point. I won't accept this. Pound. That this is true. Pound. I will fight against what really is. How do you do that? In the same way you females are fighting against male hegemony. In the same way. Right now either a female dies of exhaustion because she can't be a male and a female and live without love. Or else she's still in prison. Only now she knows she's in prison. Fighting against what's unchanging. Are you with me, boys? Are you going to fight with me? Down to death, the dungeon of existence, to fight for our own impossible possibilities, more and more, breaking into joy. Yeah, yay! Our blood was boiling with his blood. My scarf fell over my bad eye. Drink, raised bottle. Drink the wine that is the only blood we can drink until we halt this flow of cannibalism, this greed and diarrhea that's now cursing through our world. Help. Help. Captain. Second mate dare to interpose. Intervene out of his strong beliefs about human identity and will that are common to New Englanders. Don't you think you're willing too radically, and by doing so, by ignoring or going against all that has given the world, you're endangering not so importantly yourself, as all of us, your men? Your blood is and your eyes must be my eyes. The stubborn second mate continued. You've given yourself over to your work. This is what's generally happening all over the American Eastern Seaboard. For there's no other pleasure anyone can find. Your goal or job has transformed you. You're now a monster. All your energies are against what's given. You're walking death. Death is going to destroy us men. I will kill what is evil. The man who chooses isolation screams. If I destroy part of them, it's for freedom. The main characteristic of my American life is fame. Everyone wants media fame. That is total isolation. For Americans, human identity has to be beaten against the world. What are the ramifications of this situation? The ball is running in intensification. General attention comes back. The light brown haze took over the sky. Finally ground up shore seemed to be falling from the sky. Most of the houses were flattened to the ground. There were some upright building foundations. Finally ground up white shore lay over the surfaces. All of the skins of all of the people left. They felt pain. Layers of human skin killed orcs and layers of human skin. People felt hurting. Some of the people's faces were swollen to double the size. Fires starting in a dozen places moved from left to right. The railway ties blazed. The railway poles smoked either at their tops or halfway down. In the sky there was a great and enormous column of cloud. This cloud trailed a single thick blade below. Its top flattened as its body below the top swelled, opening like a flower. The cloud seemed motionless. Its head flew first to the east, then to the west, then to the east. Each time it changed its direction, part of it shot out an illumination that was reddening, purpling, rapidly gleaming. Its thin sides boiled. Its stalk twisted and grew. It was bigger than Hiroshima. The sky was an almost oblique mass of tiny particles. The cloud came toward the southeast. On the Yokogawa railway bridge track, a long freight train lay on its side. On one side of the Yokogawa railway bridge, thousands of people squatted. A loud noise happened. It shook the ground. Immediately, a column of black smoke rose to the sky from the northwest. Another loud noise happened. This happened again and again, and the columns of black smoke. Spirals in the forest above Fusabano Sato bore downward into red-hot stones. Many of the inhabitants were jammed around the train station, although the train didn't work. A man's back flesh hung neatly down from the lower part of his back, and the flesh on the back of his hands were loose like pieces of wet newspaper. Broken tiles covered the road. Out of the city center, a tremendous funnel of flame shot into the sky. The column of fire, growing, sucked in all the other fires, burnt up the Kuya department store, the Kijoku Power Supply Corporation, the Kijoku newspaper office, and the city hall. Several human bodies floated in the water below the Miyuki Bridge. Outside Hiroshima, the country floor was flat. The thousand-year-old cancer trees, firmly carbonized in shapes of trees, lay horizontal on the country floor. Silver drops of melted power cable lay scattered the sides of the road. Live wires dangled from the iron poles. Most of the dead bodies lay on their stomachs and were naked, scorched black, and in a pool of shit. The corpses were many. Round black balls lay in the sand. Bodies floated down the river. A child tried to get milk out of her dead mother's breast. The smell was nitrogen. A woman was crying her dead baby. Many living people were diarrhea and vomiting. Dear Charlotte, everything in the novel exists the sake of meaning, like the theatrical. All human is evil. So I want to go back to the first English novels. Smollett, Fielding, Stern, novels based on jokes that just fit all. Masculinity. Love and different. When a young man is a child, his parents starve to death. A Buddhist priest found the abandoned child. He brought up the child. Japan. The child, now a young man, meets a famous wise old man who says he knows something. The young man tells himself that he hasn't learned anything. The old man tells the young man to go to Buddhist school. As the wise man and the young man are conversing, policemen and prisoners tucked into them, walking by, chant that President Reagan is the best ruler, even though Reagan was the entrance into the prisoner's car. 2 years later, the wise man knows that the Reagan government's out to get him, because he's wise and the Reagan government is ignorant. He's wise because, unlike most of us nowadays, he can really touch what's really happening. The police arrest him. While the cops drag the stage nobly through the streets, a group of novice priests put the sacred chalice over the head of the young man, who's now a priest. They can't get the chalice off his head. They ask the chained wise man to help them. The wise man can't help the young man, who's lost his head, because the young man holds in Buddhist school, doesn't know anything about himself. The young man can't change himself or anything else. The wise man tells the other dumb Buddhist that the young man will find his head only when he dies. An unknown man tries to kill Reagan, but instead drops green papers. Reagan becomes more paranoid about his power. He and the sage plan to kidnap, bring up in secret, and if necessary, murder the remaining Kennedy children. They have to act, as the wise man says, in accordance with the overall historical imperative. Right now, our main historical imperative is to preserve our imagining, dreams, and our own actions, which Reagan is trying to decimate. The wise man says, you government officials surrounding Reagan assassinate him. You'll save human civilization. We can't successfully revolt against our government because they control technological, military, and psychological information and power. But there's one human power is more ruthless, greedier, and stupider than Reagan. This power lives in the Far East. An essay on the relations between government and morality. A presupposition of any government is that humans use social rules to curb their most deep, angry lust. Rousseau says that, the contrary, social rules make us act in ways we have to in order to destroy the school. This is true. Why do we need to be governed? The solution might be written, therefore useless. How can a government whose nature is power be good? Only its governor knows it's good for people. Human beings don't know in this way. A governor has to be in a morally impossible position. He has to become who his position says he is, just as an artist is exactly what is given. This powerful, stupid yellow ruler who lives in the Far East can only speak broken English. Missionaries who dared stormy seas to enter this foreign land converted his first wife to Christianity. At the present time, the United States needs missionaries more than foreign land. Since she's only yellow and slant-eyed, George Bush tries to fuck her, while the sage and yellow monster are planning to overthrow the government of the United States of America. Yellow people, see, are taking over the United States of America. They own vegetable grocers, golf courses, fashion, technological designs, and car manufacturing plants. Unlike us, they believe in wisdom. They're going to make the stage the American vice president and instill desperately needed anti-materialism. For the last 6 months, the American people have been reacting to the constant political narrative, fluctuating economy and social breakdown, by returning to their only memories of social and political stability in the past year. They're worshipping various post-capitalist phenomena, such as the nuclear planet. Such continents are now hollow or formal. Only forms are sacred, thus hypocrisy of the middle class. No nourishment for beings and energy. Nothing's real. How can anything be real? And truth is hell. Yellow books are infiltrating our civilization. Now they're destroying it. They wear 2 feet high purple hats trimmed in fur. Their eyes are the eyes of insects. Their mental tongues shoot up and down 100 miles an hour. Their men like whips better than pentagram. They are stopping the freedom of our civilization. For instance, artists in their country have to do exactly what the government officials tell them to do. They're too eradicating all Western antisocial heroism, individuality, and weirdness. All blackness, all our civilizations really depending on. The yellow books are taking away ourselves. Without white minds, white people be much happier. Wise man says. If white people can be lobotomized, white people want lobotomy. White people have no dreams beyond our cliches, which are beliefs. Actually outside our cliches, which are beliefs. President Reagan, what is Japan? Frickenstein. Can I describe know anything truthfully? No. For me, when I love, I don't know. And this is Japan. My love, the quality of the love. My love, comes within rather than is. Solitude. As for solitariness, great forests of the moon, the expanse of unnavigated waters, the Greenland ice fields, still the magic of their changeable tides and seasons mitigates their power. But the special curse of the uncontrolled is that for them change never comes, neither the change of seasons nor its sorrows. Finally, ruin itself can work little more in this place. They were cracked by an everlasting drought beneath the torrid sky. Man and wolf alike disown his land. Little but reptile life is found here. Tortoises, lizards, immense spiders, and that strangest anomaly of outlandish nature, the iguana. The yellow men captured Britain. They bow to him and say, we are not original. We take what is given, such as American medicine, do it better, then send the products, such as clothes and shoes, back to America. We adapt everything. We adapt to everything. We adapt it to fashion. Hiroshima was the way we adapted to a non-adaptable civilization. Now we give Hiroshima reality back to you. Reagan's head appears stuck in a white hole below his doorpost. Blood drips down the hole's side. Reagan's head appears stuck on a yellow pole, white and yellow door. Self is the object, not the subject. We don't adapt, we are adopted. We don't know who our father is and our mother hates us because our father abandoned her because she is 3 months pregnant. Language knows only when it cries. A child who's been hurt the devil, and must cause social pain. How is it possible to govern? During Pearl Harbor, not as in the winds of war, the white people screamed the yellow devils were going to decimate them, and the yellow people, who like my mother were very sensitive, killed themselves. Somewhere, there has been a breach of honor. Love. Yes. Dear Charlotte. As far as I can tell, both Nietzsche and Wittgenstein thought their lives were painful. Ludwig Wittgenstein was born into the midst of all possibilities, including great art and wealth. When he was a young man, he gave all his family wealth to his siblings, even though they despised him. He wanted nothing, or else he had turned against himself. He turned to study mathematics, then philosophy with Gottlob Frege, then Bertrand Russell. He left his graduate studies to live in Norway as alone as possible. He wanted nothing, or else he had turned against himself. In the end of World War I, he wrote his doctoral thesis in an Italian fascist prison. He had given away so much money by this time, he couldn't afford the travel fare back to return to Russell. When he asked Russell, Russell sent him the money. I think he hated his body, rather its demands, for he was celibate, except now and then there would be 2 or 3 weeks of violent nights, fuck every young boy by the river. The body pleasures until the desire for love and friendship turns around and vomits. As in me, the fierce longing to unite affection and sexual desire, or the mind and body, is the basis of living pain. He loved his job teaching just adolescent boys in Southern Austria. The hicks took the job away from him because they thought he was corrupting the students, but he probably wasn't. I say, I'm in pain. Is my pain hidden from you? Can you see my pain? Say there's a group of people who don't know what pretended pain is. If one of them says I'm in pain, the others cry. Someone teaches these people the phrase to simulate pain. The beggar says, I'm in pain, so please give me money. Now, is simulated pain a kind of pain? By analogy, if I accept the model of analogy, I'm asking about the relation of falsehood to reality. I can only be in pain if I know what pain is. I'm in pain, so I know what pain is. If I know what's pain, when I'm pretending pain, it's false pain, can't be pain. Now take the example of hidden pain. Example. When I feel pain as I do now with my ulcer, I pretend I'm not feeling it so you'll keep believing me and she might still love me. Hidden pain. Same simulated non-pain. Therefore, simulated pain is overt pain. This kind of logic is useless because it has nothing to do with being intentional. Your inner self is hidden from you. This means I'm unsure how to describe your words and acts. I can only guess at your feelings. I am burnt and cry out. I wouldn't call this pretending. We teach each other language. We don't teach each other to cry out. What then is pretended pain? Am I pretending to cry out to you? Nothing is hidden from you. I would assume something's hidden. Or is this assuming a psychology or a description less interesting and your intuition, the cry. I attain life, and life doesn't need affirmation. I'm lying down here.